people lose time. I'm posting a message at the same time, you know, multitask, always the same. C'est comme ça. Hello, everyone. Yeah, you can see now the Nicolas, the new decor. Nicolas done his new Kenji learning behind him and with sake bottle. We always taste many sake bottle and many sake because that's the only way to understand and to learn about sake and about what we're doing. So, Kenpai, everyone. So,
Kanpai.
Chardonnay.
Kanpai
Kenpai, Nicolas.
to Veronique Rives. She just sent a message to say hello, and it's like a lot of snow in Quebec right now.
Oh, yes. Wow. Jeez. No snow here. But snow is beautiful in Quebec whatsoever. So, hello, Veronique. It's great to see you there. No, it's very great. Very good. So, hope you're feeling well. I know it's a tough time now in restaurant business all around the world, especially in Quebec. Restaurants were closed for all the month of October. So, it's not finished till. And now in Barcelona, it's about 10 days. I'm talking about Barcelona because I live and Nicola also in Barcelona. So, it's 10 days now and they are closed. And now, just announced last night a new restriction, let's say like that. With kind of a night confinement and but very early for Barcelona and for Spain to close at 10 o'clock supposed to close at 9 at 10 o'clock everyone at home this is not fitting with restaurant business so hope everything will pass fast because we need restaurant for the pleasure of eating sharing drinking and sharing with somebody sharing with friends so but let's get into the business of yeast, the terroir of sake. That was a kind of a figure de style, kind of a metaphor to say that yeast for us it's mostly the terroir of sake. Mostly, not only for us. Yeast have a huge impact on wine, on many things, but I think even more in the sake world. So we will try to do the turn to try to understand what it's all about, the yeast and the sake. In 20 minutes, we cannot understand everything. We'll pass through just to see the impact on the aromatic profile of sake, on the taste profile, on even more than rice, water, polishing, koji, you know, all the different ingredients and different techniques that used to make sake. Yeast is, let's say, in the center of the world of sake. I think, Nicola, you agree with that.
Yes, absolutely. We say maybe this is the one with more impact and more aromatic impact that you can feel. Of course, we're going to talk about water in our next masterclass. So water is really important, but that's truly like yeast is really impactful and really different. So we're going to start talking about this.
I
You
got
start and I follow you.
I will show it later. I will talk about it, but I get two sake here. Exactly the same sake, but done with two different yeasts. So, and it's blind tasting will be both different world totally. So the impact of yeast is very important. They use in sake industry Saccharomyces cerevisiae. So same yeast that we find in wine and beer business. So and with the role of bringing alcohol. So transforming sugar and alcohol and aroma, organic compounds, so many things. But sake yeast is different from wine and beer yeast. Why? Because they can go at 20 to 22% of alcohol and the fermentation. And the selected yeast for wine at 16, more or less, they die totally. They get nuked. So that's not the case with the sake yeast, the selection of sake yeast, even if it's coming from the same family. So it's quite different on this side. Let's talk. Yeah, let's talk. I see the slide, Nicolas. Thank you. So indigenous yeast compared to selected yeast. And the history, because history is very important, like anything, human beings have select yeast, have select the best yeast to work in wine as sake, as in beer. But in history, they were working with indigenous yeast. there's a lot of new sake brewery now who work with indigenous yeast. But the problem before, not today, before mostly, today also, but mostly before, aroma deviation, problem of fermentation, stop of fermentation, volatile acidity, bacteria. So it's not easy to work with indigenous yeast, especially in the universe of sake. They were mostly for Yamari and Kimoto method. So we work at Tanaka with the Yamari and Kimoto method. So it's about working with the shubo. The shubo is the yeast starter. Shubo is the name of the yeast starter or the motto. So it's the idea of at the same time let the lactic acid bacteria naturally grow to help the yeast to develop and protect the yeast. So but with time, that was a long time ago, but with time they create the Sokoju method. So this is much more easiest way to get the yeast going on and multiply the yeast at the moment of the transformation of the starch to sugar to glucose. This is at the same time. So and they will they work with selected yeast because it's much more easy at that time. And but at the end they have a better result when they look for that. Not better result than Yamari and Kimoto. Yamari, Kimoto do very complex, very rich, very deep, very umami sake, but it's much more difficult to get achieve with that. So
Yes, one
today,
of the big
yeah, go
problem I
go.
think about indigenous yeast is also the quality, as you say, and the reproduction. Is like you're gonna have, this is a lot of small tank to make sake. You don't get like 1,000 liters. This is always small
No.
tank. When you are starting shubo, is more or less 200 liters. So if all the tank 200 liters are different, you're gonna find so many different in your sake. So you're gonna have really a large range of sake, and you need to think like this. Also, like when you are producing to get homogeneous, and you want to get a profile. So when you use selected yeast, as François gonna say, you can always reproduce more or less the same stereotype. And when you are looking for, and we know, like in Japanese culture, the poesy is important, but also the product and the result is much more important. So selected yeast is one part of it.
And working with indigenous yeast, today there's a new trend going on as natural wine, natural sake, working with indigenous yeast. The only thing you have to be careful because there's indigenous and indigenous. What's that mean? The, if there's a lot of brewery who were working with indigenous yeast a long time ago, then they have been working with selected yeast for many years, and then they're going back to indigenous yeast. So that's mean their indigenous yeast are indigenous selected from selected yeast. So the we need to be very careful with this side of a side effect. But it's very interesting, some doing very, very interesting result working that way. So selected yeast, very interesting on my point of view, because a better control of fermentation quality, getting more high quality and complex diversity. I think the word diversity is very important here. Even if we talk about selected yeast, it's about creating diversity of sake. So because the yeast has been select over the history and Japan have been selected to be adapted to each terroir of sake, each prefecture, each different kind of water. And we know our water is so important. We're going to do pretty soon a masterclass on water. This is amazing. The impact of water and sake, we can see water, it's even near to be the terroir of sake, even if it has a great impact. Rice, choice of rice, different quality, different style of rice, then polishing, then koji using. So all the yeast has been created over the years are adapt to all those different type, different way of working, different origin, different terroir. So it's quite interesting. And it's long time they selected years. The first years was selected in 1895 by the National Research and how we say that?
The National Research
NRIB,
Institute of Brewing.
Institute of Brewery, well, in Japan, 1895. So, and the trend since 1906 was to create very aromatic yeast, but with low acidity. So this is one of the first reason why sake has less acidity, because we always compare to wine. There's like five times more or less acidity in a sake than in wine. So it's quite important and a taste point of view and a matching with food point of view, because acidity has a huge impact in the matching wine and food, and sake and food, and everything with food. So it's quite interesting to see when you go back in history about that, especially the aromatic, the very aromatic yeast were selected since that time. They were producing a lot of kind of molecule of ethyl coproate, ethyl isoamyl. So we talk about melon, pear, banana, apple. So that's why we find a lot of those kind of aroma and the traditional sake, the one who used to be and still very, very traditional. They use this kind of yeast. So you want to add something, Nicola?
Yeah, you know, I love the historic part of the reason
yes.
why.
Yes.
you need to know, like, the National Research Institute of Brewing was created in 1904, and in 1906 they released the first yeast, just for one reason. That's the Ministry of Finance of Japan would create this, just because before 1945, the sake was like taxes at the production. And of course, so you tax at the production, but if the sake is spoiled and bad, you need to give back the money to the brewery. So all the Japanese government and the financial government of Japan always help a lot in research, creating yeast to the sake brewery like this. When they pay at the production, you don't give back the money, because it was like really, really important, the sake money at this moment. Now there is technology and more business, but in 1906, it was really a significant part of the estate revenue. And step by step, as you say, like it's the evolution of terroirs, the evolution of taste. This evolution you can start to control and to find the yeast you like. And I'm pretty sure you're gonna talk about the Ginjo yeast, isn't it, in 1980?
Yeah, there's so many things to talk about. So no, you know, yeasts are named by numbers mostly. So number one, number two, number eight were developed, like Nicola was saying, for purpose of money, but also to finishing the fermentation, because it's difficult to achieve fermentation to 16, 17, 18, 19, sometimes 20, especially at that time. When we go back in time today, sake is more near of between 14 to 16, but there was a lot of sake still at 20, 19, 18. So we need to finish the fermentation. If you don't finish, you don't achieve the fermentation, you lose the sake. So there's a cost linked to that, and there's a tax to the governments linked to that always. Number six and number seven are still used today. All the other one before, so 5-4 to go to one, are not really used. Number six was developed at Aramasa, amazing, great sake producer. It was developed in 1935. So it's a less fruity than number seven. Number seven is a Masumi in 1946. And this is a very fruity banana style yeast. And it's a lot of brewery you work with number seven. Even some name of sake are linked to number seven yeast. So when you see this number on a label, you can be sure this is yeast number seven. So, but it get more acidity, but not very aromatic like they were before. So, but we get after that. Nicola was just opening the door to the Ginjo area, the boom of Ginjo in the 1980s. 1980s is great time for sake. They start to doing less Junmai and doing a lot of Ginjo sake, while aromatic sake, very fruity, less acidity than before, but very aromatic, very sexy, very charming sake to get and contest and win medal. That was the first purpose of those sake at the time. So, but still, those sake are very, very interesting, working with different kind of yeast, especially number 11, which is a variant of number 7, which is drier finish. So this is interesting on my point of view, because a lot of Daiginjo are a bit sweetie style and mild. So to be able to get a Daigenjo with a drier finish on my fat, I like it, especially when it's time to drink at the table to do some match and just drinking sake while you're eating. I like the dry finish, but depend what you're looking for. Depend what the Toji is looking for. The Toji is the master brewer at the sake brewery. Some like this full sweet attack, and that's what they're looking for, depending of each brewery. So, and the next major drive and the sake yeast was yeast number 9 and number 10. Very interesting, with more aroma. And this was preceding mostly at the same time of the Genjo yeast development. So, and then they arrived with new modern yeast number 14, 1801, 1901. Very, very aromatic yeast, but again, less acidity, always because of the influence of the Genjo. That was a new trend. The Daigenjo create a huge trend in the sake business. So, and still, so, but since here, a couple of years, Jumai is coming back. Why? Because Jumai sake could be so umami, so dry, so straightforward. Sometime with a little bit more acidity, depending of the way the brewery work. We looking for more acidity. That's what we are looking for. So changing many path. We are change Nicola and I 10 steps on the making of sake at Tanaka to get different sake to blend after that, to try to achieve what we are looking for, a sake with a more white wine profile without losing his DNA, his soul of sake. That's very interesting. So, and this opened the door to the blending idea of yeast, not only blending sake, blending yeast. We didn't invent nothing. There's a lot of blending and the yeast, modern, we'll say the modern yeast, modern sake production. So, why? Because to get more aroma at the end, so by blending different kind of yeast and to get more acidity or more umami or better dry finish, that one yeast cannot achieve all that. So let's say blending yeast 1801 or 1601, which is more strawberry aroma. Not only, but dominant of strawberry aroma in 1601 yeast. So, and at the same time, you blend this year by using a classic yeast like 901 to get more umami and less bitterness at the end. So, and how can you achieve that? So, there's many ways. One of the ways is to use to mix yeast very easily and a shubo. The shubo is the fermentation starter. This is the mother of sake. So that's the what I was saying is the moment where you start transforming the starch and glucose, and at the same time starting to develop a lot of yeast because of lactic bacteria naturally or add. Shukujo is add. Kimoto Yamae is naturally provoke. So and so if you mix yeast there, you will get more complexity depending which complexity you are looking for. Or you can create different shubo. So you get, like in Tanaka, we have 20 tanks, small tanks of shubo to make 200 liter of shubo and all those different tanks. And there you can choose to work with different yeast, one yeast different than each shubo. You can do that. Kimoto, Yamae, depending on how you're working, but you can do that. Or you can create different sake, make with different yeast, and then blend the sake. What we are doing. I'm just saying that to show to do the to show how it's possible, but we had done that and we still do that for now, just doing different sake. Blend 001, it's a mix of seven different sake. So all with different rice, different temperature, Kimoto and different yeast to achieve what we were looking for. So that's the way the blend's been done, and that way. You want to add something, Nicola, before we go to forming yeast?
Yeah, just usually that's a question quite hard to answer. This is how you buy yeast and all this stuff. You buy it directly to the government. So that's amazing. One more time to government to get money, and you got this. This is like the small bottle. You got yeast inside, and you just put it on your rice, and you start the fermentation. And that's a really nice business because 10 little bottle of this is more or less 150 euros. and you need 3 bottles of it to make 100 kilo of rice. So one more time, this is how you buy it. This is how industry works. And then they use this money to make more research. But it's a big, always pushing the industry behind, and the way of working is a little bit different than the wine industry. As we used to say, don't compare always wine and sake. That's really two different industries, the way of working and the way of thinking, and more the philosophy.
Yeah, exactly. So all this kind of yeast for aromatic profile, texture profile, umami or dryness at the end, more acidity, less acidity. But there's also non-foaming yeast. There was a non-foaming yeast revolution totally in Japan, because you need to go there to see that the first time. We can post some picture after that. A 200 liter tank will do during the fermentation, during what we call mohomi. So we'll do 100 liter of foam. Yes, so huge foam, like the mar on wine, huge foam, a very sticky foam. So this is a real problem, because it takes space first. So to do 200 liter of sake with 100 liter of foam, you lose 100 liter of space. So it's a real nightmare. It used to be. Today it's different, because they have created yeast that can control this foaming. And at the same time, looking for yeast with quality, aromatic compound, acidity, bitterness, umami. So when you read about yeast and books, you will see the yeast that finishing by 01, 601, 701, 901. They are non-foaming yeast. All the 01 yeast, finally, by final 01, they are the non-foaming. 80% of the market today is with non-foaming yeast. 80%, still 20%. So I don't know what they do. It's a kind of nightmare. I've seen at Tanaka, you know, they put some motor on top, directly on the tanks, with a fan that goes, and inox that goes directly over the hat of foam, and trying to put some air and put the break the foam, because this is a very sticky foam. This is very problematic. So, and then for sure, the impact, the most important impact in the yeast development, I said it before, was the Daiginjo time. They have created so much interesting yeast. Some have been developed after that and during for Junmai, not only for Daiginjo. So there's quite interesting impact there. Let's show here. Like I was saying, I got two sake. Those are sampled directly from tank that I received in Barcelona from Tanaka directly. So before blending, and on my left glass on my side, this is with Miyagi B3 yeast. This is a local yeast from Miyagi. Miyagi is the prefecture where is situated Tanaka Shuso Brewery, where we do the project Tanaka 1789 in Chartier. So, and this is a Junmai Daiginjo, 60% Polish. And on the right side, this is 24, but this is yeast number 7. So more fruity, more aromatic, totally jump to the glass. I'm sorry, Nico, you don't have, we are not in the same office today. You don't have the same sake, but you got enough sake on your desk. So very fruity, very, very, not watermelon, green melon, very, a little bit, not banana, but mostly very near of banana. Then when we go back to Miyagi, still attractive, but still more close, not as fruity, more floral and more lactones aroma, a little touch of anise-like. So here is with the Miyagi, a very nice acidity at the attack, because we done that. I want to achieve to get that because of the Kimoto, because the way we work with Miyagi, because the rice less polished at 60%. So all those steps we had changed that, we achieved to have a sake here with only 3 times less acidity than wine. Then normally it's 5 to 6 times less. So a good acidity attack, good acidity backbone at the end. And when we taste this one is number 7. This is more fruity. This is Daiginjo yeast first. So very fruity, very sweet texture. There's no sugar, but the sweet finish at the end. So you see, the impact of yeast is very important at final. There's much more than that, for sure. For rice, water is very important. But we can identify in a blind tasting. Some of you are sommelier. You used to taste blind. Nicolas tastes blind very well. We all taste blind. Blind tasting, we can recognize the type of yeast. If you used to sake, You will, that's the way you will travel and manage. See, this is Daiginjo, Junmai Daiginjo, Junmai Suk. You know, you will travel to that, but identify the rice. I don't know anybody who can do that. This is very difficult to identify the rice. If I tell you this is done with Yamada Nishiki, you say, wow, amazing, one of the top rice, if not the best rice to make sake. I give you 10 glasses of sake in front of you. Tell me the rice of each. You won't be able. All the professionals in Japan try to do that. There's more than 100 variety of rice. There's an impact on the terroir, on the cultivation of rice, like the grapes, the land, the climates, the of each variety, of each valley, the farming method. You know, it's so different. And then the influence of yeast and water. Water have a huge influence in the sake brewing. We talk about harness, hard water or soft water. So in Japan, it's mostly soft water, but not everywhere. So there's some different spot in Japan where the water is harder, change totally the aromatic point of view, the texture, the acidity level, the pH. There's an impact on the pH directly. Are we okay with the time, Nicola?
Yes, we are okay. Yeah.
Okay, so this water, we will do, Nicola has written, and I pass over a great text on water impact on sake brewing, and this is quite interesting. So
and this masterclass, masterclass is going to be the 16th of November about water in sake, yeah.
Exactly, 16th of November will be our next masterclass here at this community, the Sakigraphy community. But before, there will be two masterclasses. There will be one on 5th of November with the Japanese Sommelier Association in Japan. That will be on Zoom live, but we will put that after same day on Facebook and on the Tanaka Sakigraphy community. And I will do also a masterclass on November 9th. This is like 90% confirmed, but we will do masterclass each month, once a month over the next 4 months with the Association Canadienne des Sommeliers Professionnels, so CAPS Association in Canada and Quebec. So that will be in French. Those one will be in French. The one in Japan will be in English because Nihongo ga dekimasen. My Japanese is not yet perfect as my Spanish. So that's why Nicolas look at me like that. So we will finish with that. So hope you understand a little bit more what we are doing. We are intent to share in the Sakigraphy community. And we will. You can go on the website, Tanaka 1789, at the Sakigraphy space. We just just post the text of this Sake masterclass on yeast, more detail with graph. You get a lot of information, so you can go on the web to go get it if you just register for free at the Sake community.
I think you say everything. Yeah, I just sent the link for people who want to read. Sorry, I was a little bit late.
Thank you.
You're welcome. No, that's was really important to say, and you get so many much more info on the text. It was, as you say, quite complex to explain everything, the new yeast and what's happened in the yeast world. And there is amazing stuff all around the world, so please try sake, feel it, and This
Yeah,
one
we
was a good
share.
one. Yeah, Nida,
Yeah, this is.
if you find this, this is from Fukushima. This is from one hour south in our brewery. We are in Sendai. This is Fukushima. This is one hour south. This look like, I like to put it like in Albarino style in Galles, you know. This is always when you want to enjoy easy and really love it. That's quite a good one. If you can find it, it's interesting.
It's
and
like
transport.
Someone or something. Here. This.
Yeah.
I was thinking of that while I was talking about rice and about the impact of yeast. This amazing sake brewery, I've done a different sake, but this sake and another one coming from the same terroir, same plot, same rice, same water, same yeast, everything. Everything 100% exactly the same way. They done two sake, and the two sake are different. So there's not only terroir, there's not only rice, not only water, not only yeast. Everything has an impact, and that was a great surprise at Tanaka for me, but a great surprise for the Toji, because we asked him to change the way to make sake for us, different path, not totally, but different step. And at the end, sometimes there's two or three tanks, exactly the same way we asked, but because of the volume. And at the end, we don't use the three tanks. We use only one or two. We blend it differently. And he was not understanding. I said, yes, taste the three tank. It's three sake. It's not the same sake at all. So there's something mystic, magic, and the sake brewery is the same in wine, but I don't find this same difference. Difference are amazing here. So, and a good way to make it, if you go to Japan or if you find that on the market, they have done, I got this one, I don't remember the name, I don't have the other bottle. There was two written by hand like that. So, and this is one of the proof. It's very subtle, but the difference, and it's high end, it's very, very good. So that was the question of today. Is yeast or the sake terroir? Poser la question, c'est y répondre souvent, mais c'est pas le cas ici. Je crois que c'est beaucoup plus. Il y a beaucoup plus que les levures pour avoir un impact. To have an impact on the sake profile, but they are one of the major impacts. So thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, Nicolas, and see you November 16th, but maybe on the 5th and on the 9th for two other masterclass.
If you
Merci,
get any
Derek.
Question, you can reach us on Instagram, Facebook, or whatever, and we can answer it.
Goodbye.
Whoa. Goodbye.